Hello, my name is Joe. I already filmed half this video and I realized that my microphone was not on, so we're just gonna run through the intro quickly. I have been recovering from the flu, so I'm sorry if my voice is terrible. Today we are going to talk about some of the books that I read as a kid or a teen growing up in the fundamentalist Christian community, and I think these are fucked up, and I think that they kind of demonstrate the indoctrination that happens in these communities. So today we are specifically going to be talking about fictional books. There are obviously non-fictional books that also have a big role in indoctrinating kids, but I do think that fictional books are probably more powerful in a lot of ways because they are beloved. Most of these books, when I read them, I loved them. So small disclaimer, I have not reread these books. I do not ever intend to reread these books. So we are working off of, you know, 10 to 20 year old memories of these. I did look up summaries and some reviews and stuff of them just to make sure that I was, you know, on track. But bear in mind, this may not be 100% accurate. We're just going to start with Elsie, Dinsmore, which is a series. It was written a long time ago, but it was republished by Vision Forum, which is just a rotting garbage can of an organization that I think thankfully is now defunct. But this series, it has been rewritten, you know, brought up to modern times or whatever, but I'm speaking about the original books. So they were republished and kind of took the conservative fundamentalist community by storm. This is a series following a little girl who I believe is 8 at the beginning of the series, who lives in a pre-Civil War South. She is in a very wealthy slave-owning family. It's kind of glossed over, I think, but I mean, it's very much there, but I think people kind of gloss over it in their minds when they think about this series, but very much so. All of the racism that you'd expect from that is there. She has a, you know, a nanny character who is exactly what you'd expect a black enslaved nanny character to be. All of those things are there in full force. This is also a series that is chock full of abuse, and I mean extreme abuse. So Elsie is living with her grandparents, who I believe are abusive as well at the beginning of the book, and then her father comes back from Europe or wherever he's been gallivanting about. Her mother died in childbirth, so she goes to live with her father, and he is a terrible person. And so she is an extremely devout, extremely pious Christian. Whatever you're imagining in your head, multiply that by 300, 3,000, I don't care. She clashes with her father about absolutely everything. He is not a Christian at the time when the book starts, and she feels that she has to follow God's commandments above him, although she does think that he, you know, owns her and all these other, you know, things. But she refuses to do what he says when he says to do extremely, you know, immoral, unethical, ungodly things, such as reading fiction on Sundays or playing secular music on the piano. Just horrific things. But anyway, so when she, you know, refuses to do that, he has completely outsized abusive reactions. He beats her. At one point, he tells the servants to not speak to her until she does whatever it is that he wants her to do, and he also does not speak to her, and it takes like months, so she's living like months with no one speaking to her. She is just, you know, weeping all the time. I think if you took out all of the portions that she's crying or agonizing, wringing her hands over what to do, I don't even think you could have the first like 3 books. But regardless, eventually she essentially has a nervous breakdown. I think it gets some kind of fever or something and almost dies, and her father becomes a Christian because of this, comes around. They still have a lot of like disgusting power dynamics after that, but it's supposedly happy ever after. Speaking of happy ever after, there's also disgusting grooming. The father himself has a very, very weird relationship with her. There's a lot of physical contact described between the two of them that is very disturbing. Some of the reviews that I read said that she is talked about in a very, very sexual way for like an 8-year-old. I, you know, haven't read it recently enough to be able to remember that level of detail, but I do remember there being a lot of like kissing and embracing and weirdness. Beyond that, her father's best friend is in love with her from the time that she is 8 years old. And he regularly says that he wishes that she was 10 years older so that he could marry her. Then he does. When she grows up, they get married. Not at all weird. Nothing to see here. And this is presented again as happily ever after. I know, because I talked to people when I was a kid, that thought that this was like the greatest romance of all time. Disgusting! This is only scratching the surface of everything that's wrong with this series, so, you know, I don't even know where to begin or end talking about that, so we're gonna end there. But that also kind of brings in that there was a lot of like Southern sympathizing in a lot of the literature and movies and that sort of thing. I personally did not read a lot of that. My mom did not ascribe to the Southern sympathizing at all, thankfully, so that's not something that I grew up with, but it was present, absolutely. I did read one book. I think we got a gift or something of an audiobook that was a Southern sympathizing, like, adventure book. I was not able to find it because I cannot remember enough about it to find the name, and it probably, you know, very likely does not even exist anymore, but it was all about the amazing, scrappy integrity of the Confederates against the unethical whatever Union soldiers, and I did read it and I enjoyed it, but I also definitely had the perspective that it was not the way that it actually was, and that even if there were, you know, scrappy, clever Confederate soldiers, which I don't doubt that there were, they were fighting for something completely wrong. So thankfully I did have enough, you know, background to understand that at the time, but most kids reading those books probably did not. So our second book is the first of two I'm going to talk about by Francine Rivers. Francine Rivers is an extremely popular Christian author, not just in fundamentalism. She's a pretty mainstream author. I think even non-Christians read her books as well, but she has two books in particular that I have major, major issues with. The first one is The Atonement Child, and this is basically just a long novel of anti-abortion propaganda. So she has set up essentially what should be the perfect scenario in which abortion would generally be considered by almost everyone in the United States as justified. Like, obviously, I don't think it needs to be justified, but a lot of people do, and so she has set up that scenario. We have our main character is a very devout, wonderful, white, middle-class Christian girl who has gone to a Christian college, and she is attacked and she becomes pregnant. She, you know, was saving herself for marriage and everything, and so she and her mom and her grandmother and, you know, everybody around her is trying to figure out what to do. And so obviously their family and their community and everything are extremely anti-abortion, but her mom and I think her dad and pretty much everybody are like, you know what, normally we're opposed to this, but like this is a situation in which I don't want you to have to do this, so, you know, we'll support you. I think that maybe you should consider getting an abortion. She does consider it. I think she maybe even goes to the clinic. There's all this back and forth, you know, all the options of what is she gonna do, blah, blah, blah. So eventually it comes to light that her mother and her grandmother have both had abortions. So I think if I'm remembering correctly, in the grandmother's case, her life was in danger. And in the mother's case, it was just an unwanted pregnancy. You know, it was like the 70s or something, and she, you know, had an abortion. This could have been a really interesting thing because, again, this is like a fact. A lot of people who are to consider themselves anti-abortion have had or would be willing to have an abortion if the right set of circumstances came along. But, of course, that wasn't how it was handled whatsoever. both of them are absolutely racked with guilt, with, you know, baggage about this. I believe both of them had fertility issues because of their abortion, or they may not have said it was because of it, but it's implied that it was because of it. They are grieving over it, you know, decades later. And obviously that's a possibility. That's something that could happen. But that is not the vast majority of people who get abortions. The vast majority of people who get abortions do not regret it later and do not have long-term physical, you know, effects. But you would never guess that based on the fact that everybody present in this book who had an abortion is absolutely destroyed with guilt over it and has long-term, you know, physical issues because of it. She, of course, does end up having the kid, and she also, like, falls in love with someone who has to, like, come to terms with this, I think. And it was just, in my opinion, it's a book that purports to be and gets a lot of credit for being a super, like, nuanced and understanding and gentle perspective on pro-life, you know, and that's how, honestly, how I read it as a teen, because it was very much like you sympathize with her and you understand why she would choose abortion. But to me, all of this concern and, you know, gentle handling of it is fake, because this is ultimately a book about the fact that even if you have one of the most, you know, horrific, violating experiences that it can be possible for a human to have, you still shouldn't have an abortion, you know? And it's like, again, if that's a choice that someone makes, absolutely, I support them 100%. But they're, again, saying that, like, that's the choice that you should make, and it just, nope. 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 The next book by her is Redeeming Love, and this is a retelling of the story of Hosea from the Bible, and that is kind of how a lot of the problematic things get kind of washed away online. If someone leaves a review talking about it, I saw a lot of response comments being like, well, this is just a retelling of a story from the Bible, so, like, that's just what happened. And I was like, well, okay. Our main characters are a man working in the gold rush and a prostitute working in the gold rush. She was trafficked as a literal child, I think like 8 years old, and has been in prostitution ever since. So the guy, who is, you know, devout and all of that, is told by God directly that she is the one for him and that he needs to marry her. So he goes, I assume has to buy her out of prostitution. I assume that's how that would work. I don't think you get to just show up and be like, hey, I want to marry this one. Give her to me. I can't remember that specifically. So he takes her to his house. Again, like, I don't remember her being into this. Like, I don't think she was like, oh, yay, you rescued me. There's this whole big deal. I think almost the whole middle part of the book is, like, he waits to have sex with her until she's ready, because he's so good, you know? And so it's this big, you know, look at how great this man is who's struggling against desire and temptation against this woman who he married against her will, basically, and has been sexually abused for her entire life. She is essayed in the book by his brother, and he forgives her for it. This whole thing is him having to forgive her for her sins, and she runs away like 3 times. Again, that's in the Bible story, but she runs away. She does not want to be with him. Eventually, she does want to be with him, but, like, have we ever heard of Stockholm Syndrome? Like, it was so bad. I mean, we are talking about a person who was sold into slavery at the age of 8, sexually abused for her entire life, human trafficked, and we're forgiving her. I can't. I'm sure there was so many other things in this book, but, like, that's enough. So,
wait, so I'm so confused. I was looking for the cover of this book and I saw that they just made a movie just this year for this book. What the hell? And it looks like it was even, like, fairly high budget. Like, Nina Dobrev was in it. It did get terrible reviews, though, which is pretty funny.
Moving into some genre fiction, we have Frank Peretti, who is the author of This Present Darkness and An Ever-Present Darkness or something like that. So I don't remember these books super well, but these are like Christian horror books. And they were about, you know, the force of evil in the world. So everything in the world is evil. And there are angels and demons, and they are like very, very active forces in society, which like could be, you know, cool, whatever. Like, I thought that Terry Pratchett and Neil Gaiman book was just as funny as everybody else, but of course that's not what this is. This is like anything that's not overtly fundamentalist Christian is from the devil. So spirituality, any religion other than Christianity, particularly Eastern religions, any kind of like happiness, a selfish desire of any kind, anything like that is from the devil. But it's written as horror, so it's very much like in people's heads that they have these like demons speaking to them and tempting them to do all of these things. And it's like very unnerving because it's not just a horror novel, you know, like if you've grown up in that society, that, you know, subculture, that's how you think it actually is. So like it's a very like disturbing thing to read about. Speaking of disturbing things to read about, we have the Left Behind series. And again, this is one of those things that I think was a slightly cultural phenomenon. You know, I don't think that only Christians read these or watched these movies. It's about the apocalypse, it's about the rapture, and then the subsequent tribulation, based loosely on the book of Revelations in the Bible. So the idea is that all Christians, born-again Christians only, will get raptured up into heaven, so they just disappear, and then everyone else goes through a time of tribulation where they are tested, and if you become a Christian during that time, you are saved. But otherwise, if you do not, then when the actual Armageddon happens, you will go to hell forever and there will be no more earth. I mean, again, I think they were like a larger cultural phenomenon, but within Christianity, I cannot emphasize enough how much of an impact these had. So there were like fundamentalist sects who did not like these because they were like obviously very commercial, and also a lot of people don't believe in the rapture. It's not super well supported biblically. Like, you can read it either way, but not everybody liked this, but a lot of people did. There were YA versions of the Left Behind books. There were obviously movies. There were, I think, graphic novels. Like, this whole thing went wild. I read a bunch of the YA ones. I read a bunch of the adult ones, and I was terrified. Like, again, this is gonna seem ridiculous, but it's hard to imagine from the outside what it's like when you believe that all of this stuff is real. Like, genuinely, if I saw piles of clothes around the house sometimes, I would be absolutely terrified until I found my family members and knew that they were not raptured. This was, like, straight up traumatic for me. Like, I enjoyed them also, which is really weird, but they were also truly viscerally terrifying to me, so that's fun. And then we have just like a category of books that I think a lot of books fall into that are essentially just, you'll be abused and you'll like it and you will thank God for it. So Hinds Feet in High Places is a very, very aggressive allegory. Like, our main character is Much Afraid, that's her name. And she's kind of our, like, Christian who's struggling to be saved. She has all kinds of family members and townspeople around her who are also named things that are, like her cousin is named Craven Fear. They're supposed to be attributes and, you know, whatever. She is trying to follow the Good Shepherd, and Everybody's like stopping her. She is a big old baby, as much afraid would sound like she is. She's always letting everybody trample all over her. Everybody abuses her. Everybody does terrible things to her. Yeah, it's all just about her learning how to follow the good shepherd. But mostly, you need to stand up for yourself, not for yourself, but for God. Instead of letting people trample all over you, you need to let God's will trample all over you. Other books that I think would slightly fall into this would be Not My Will and Stepping Heavenward, which were both less dramatic books along the same lines, where you're following someone who's going through all kinds of trauma and bad things in their life. It's never about like anything that gives them any kind of autonomy or decision making or anything like that. It's always just them, like, as the title would suggest, not my will, like giving into God's will, which often, you know, coincidentally looks a lot like the man in their lives' will. So they have to, you know, submit to their husbands, submit to God's will, submit to their fathers. They have to give up everything that they want in order to follow God's will and all of these things. So essentially just teaching young girls how to not stick up for themselves, how to not ever get what they want ever in their lives, and how to be victimized. Good stuff. So that was the list. That's pretty much all I have to say. So I would love to hear discussion in the comments if you have any thoughts or have read any of these books, and I will see you in the next video.